Thank you. A very good morning to you and welcome to the 20th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have received no apologies for this meeting, and our first item of business for today is a decision to take agenda items 4 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you. Our next item is the final evidence session of our inquiry into addressing child poverty through parental employment. Previously, we have held evidence sessions on childcare, education, employability, family-friendly working and transport. Today, we're going to hear from the Scottish Government on some of these themes, as well as social security rules and governance. Policy coherence and evaluating policy impact. I first welcome to the meeting Shirley-Ann Somerville, Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, and Natalie Dawn, Minister for Children, Young People and Keeping the Promise. And Natalie will be joining us shortly. And officials supporting them are Matthew Farrell, Head of Strategy, Finance and Performance, Julie Humphreys, Deputy Director, Tackling Child Poverty and Financial Wellbeing, and Anne McKenzie, Unit Head, Tackling Child Poverty Policy Unit, Scottish Government, who are joining us in the room. And I welcome Graeme Day, Minister for Higher and Further Education, and Jane Duffy, Unit Head, Post-School Qualifications, Scottish Government. And they are all joining us remotely. So thank you for joining us today. Cabinet Secretary, I believe you would like to start with a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning. I'm grateful to the committee for inviting myself and my ministerial colleagues along to give evidence today. Tackling poverty and protecting people from harm is one of the three critical and interdependent missions for the government, as the First Minister stated last week. It is clear that economic growth goes hand in hand with tackling poverty. A programme for government commits to increasing the pay of up to 100,000 social care and childcare staff, to rolling out universal free school meals for all pupils in primary 6 and 7, starting with those children in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment, and to introducing a pilot for the removal of ScotRail peak time fares. Driving forward action at greater pace and scale to meet our ambitious targets remains at the heart of the work across all portfolios. However, the harm inflicted by the UK government's austerity-driven policies and the ongoing cost of the union crisis is making our job considerably harder. If the UK government reversed key welfare reforms that were introduced in 2015, that would help lift 70,000 people out of poverty this year, including 30,000 children, and put £780 million back in the pockets of low-income households. Best Start Bright Futures outlines the wide-ranging actions this government and our partners will take to reduce child poverty in Scotland. Increasing incomes from work and earnings is an important aspect of our overall approach. That is why we remain committed to scaling the reach and effectiveness of our devolved employability services for low-income parents to enter, sustain and progress within employment, and have made £108 million available for the delivery of employability services this year. We have also set clear priorities for reform of post-school education to deliver a lifelong education, research and skills system that enables everyone to fulfil their potential. It is deeply frustrating that employment law remains a reserved matter in the hands of the Conservative government, a view shared by trade unions across the UK, who this week backed calls for the employment law to be devolved to the Scottish Parliament. Despite this, we have set out a number of wide-ranging actions in our refreshed Fair Work Action Plan, published in December last year, which aim to tackle labour market inequalities, and we are committed to working with businesses to address Scotland's labour market participation challenges, starting with a focus on health and the needs of parents, particularly those in the 6 priority groups, to help reduce child poverty. We know that high-quality, affordable and accessible childcare plays a critical role in supporting employment and the economy. Scotland already has the most generous childcare offer anywhere in the UK, supporting families and helping to give children the best possible start in life. Our programme for government sets out ambitious commitments to delivering a significant expansion of targeted childcare provision, focused on tackling child poverty and supporting more parents to take up or sustain employment. We also understand that a sustainable exit from poverty will never be just about securing and retaining a job, and that is why we are taking much wider action to tackle poverty. This includes continued investment to deliver more affordable homes, our commitment to transforming how family support is delivered, with a focus on shifting towards early intervention and prevention, supported by the Whole Family Wellbeing Fund, and our continued investment in the likes of our game-changing Scottish Child Payment, which has put more than £350 million into the pockets of low-income families since the payment launched in February 2021. The way that actions are delivered are key to the plan's success. The creation of the Tackling Child Poverty Programme Board, supplemented by the formation of a new ministerial group on delivery of Best Start Bright Futures, will ensure robust governance and coordinated implementation. We are delivering in the most challenging circumstances, with our block grant funding 4.8% lower in real terms than it was in 21-22 at the time this budget was set. And over the past 5 years, over the past five financial years, we have mitigated £711 million worth of Tory cuts, including the bedroom tax, the freeze on local housing allowance and the benefit cap, through activities such as discretionary housing payments and the Scottish Welfare Fund. Our action is making a difference. Modelling estimates that 90,000 fewer children will live in relative and absolute poverty this year as a result of this government's policies, with poverty levels 9 percentage points lower than they would have been otherwise. This includes lifting an estimated 50,000 children out of relative poverty through the Scottish Child Payment. But we know there is more to do. So we will continue to do everything within the scope of the powers and the limited budget we have to tackle poverty and support those in greatest need, strengthening that support where we can. I will very much welcome the committee's inquiries, the opportunity for my ministerial colleagues and I to answer your questions and, of course, to your conclusions and recommendations in due course. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We will now start by focusing on employability. And we have Graeme Day joining us remotely. And so I'm going to start with theme two, and I'm going to bring in Jeremy. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and good morning, Minister, and to all your team. It's good to have you here today. I wonder if I can address my first question, perhaps, to Mr. Day. I'm just wondering, when will the Scottish Government deliver its lifelong learning offer, and how will it ensure that lifelong learning is accessible, particularly to low-income parents?
First of all, I'm going to thank the committee for allowing me to contribute from Stornoway, where I'm visiting the local college. I think in the context of this is a work in progress, there's no doubt about that, but I think we've made significant progress, and the reform agenda which we are embarking upon will afford us further opportunity to build on that. Mr. Balfour will be aware of the increasing levels of financial support that we've been providing. We've recently increased the undergraduate support by £900 and announced an 11% plus increase to the maximum bursary rates and FE for 23-24. And obviously we're now considering how we prioritise our programme for government commitment to reform student support within the context of the fixed budget and very challenging financial circumstances we're in. So from that point of view, that is an ongoing exercise, as is looking overall at what we do to deliver best for the people who need the most support in order to access the post-schools education system.
I wonder if I can just come back a wee bit, Matt. You started your opening statement by saying a lot of progress has been made, and then you talked about two payments. What other progress has been made in the last couple of years, would you say?
Well, I think, Mr. Balfour, I'm sure you would recognise the progress that's been made and improving things through the widening access programme, hitting our target as early as we did. But we absolutely don't rest in our laurels. We are working very closely with our partners at FE and HE to see what more we can do to improve access to both sectors for people from the poorest backgrounds.
One of the commitments made within the SNP manifesto at the last election was to introduce a special support payment so that students who are on receipt of benefits do not lose out because they are on receipt of or entitled to student support. When do you think that manifesto commitment will be delivered?
Well, as already touched upon, Mr Balfour, that is something we're looking at currently, and it's how we prioritise that commitment. But I'm sure you will recognise the very challenging financial circumstance that we're in, but that is something we're working on.
I don't want to be a wee bit, Minister. It's a wee bit vague for people who are listening. We are working on it. You know, I'm sure you know that could be used for lots of policies. Have you any indication of when that manifesto commitment will actually be delivered, which you promised to make?
In the context of this parliamentary term, it was the commitment that was made, and that's what we're working towards. I'm sorry I can't be more specific. I'm not trying to be difficult or vague in any way. I'm being as open with you as I can. It is something we're looking at currently, but we are in an incredibly challenging financial set of circumstances.
And just finally, I'd be glad to hear from you, Minister. If that is going to be introduced, will that require regulations, or can it be done within the existing powers that you have at the moment?
Can I bring in Jane Duffy, my official, on that to give you the detail, if I may?
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. One of the factors we have to consider in this is working with DWP and making sure that we're doing everything within our devolved competency and working with them so that we don't trip anything up in terms of the benefits that students are already offering. So there are discussions with DWP next week, and we're hoping to finalise the details and just check that our proposals don't go against their rules and don't go against our devolved competency. We are checking to see with DWP that it's deliverable for the academic year 24-25, and we are hoping to make an announcement on that by the end of this year. So I hope that helps.
That's very helpful. And can I just one final clarification on that? If it is possible and the negotiations go well with DWP, would it be delivered by DWP or would it be delivered by the new Scottish Security Agency?
I think we're still finalising those details to make sure which is the best route to do it and which one we're able to deliver efficiently and quickly. But we'll be able to give more details on that as soon as possible.
Thank you, Camilla.
Okay, thank you very much. So, and thank you to the Minister for attending remotely. So this concludes our discussion on the theme of employability, education and training. Can I thank you again, and thanks to your officials as well. So we'll now briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a panel change before we move on to the next theme. Thanks very much. Welcome back. And I'd like to welcome Natalie Dawn, Minister for Children, Young People and Keeping the Promise. I would like to invite the theme childcare, and I'm going to bring in Paul. Thank you.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel, indeed to the minister. Perhaps just thinking about the current childcare offer and then the kind of plans that were announced in terms of looking to expansion, to what extent does the government expect the childcare policy to reduce child poverty in time to meet the 2030 targets that have been obviously set through the Child Poverty Act?
Thank you very much for the question. High-quality early learning childcare clearly has a positive impact on all children's outcomes, and I think the evidence shows that it has a greater positive impact on children living in poverty. It can also support parents to work, train or study, and I know that the committee have heard that during evidence, and it can have a direct impact on the drivers of child poverty through supporting household incomes. So in terms of our current offer and previous modelling published by IPPR Scotland estimated that 600 hours funded ELC in Scotland lifted over 10,000 adults and children out of poverty. And they note that the expansion to 1140 hours still will have an even bigger impact. And obviously, as Mr O'Kane has referred to, our programme for government setting out how we will go even further to that. Under the existing 1140 offer, if families paid for this themselves, it would cost them around £5,000 per child per year, and that is a huge amount of money. Independent research shows that 97% of parents are satisfied with the quality of funded ELC, and there is a range of ongoing work focused on delivering a robust and accurate evidence base and evaluation of the impact of 1140 hours itself, including an economic evaluation of the expansion. So the baseline phases of the Scottish study of ELC were published in 2019 to 2020, and the fourth phase is on track to begin data collection in October. This will give us a clearer idea of the impact that our current offer is having, and obviously that will be further looked at as the programme is expanded.
Thank you, convener. I wonder, I mean, I'm interested in that analysis because I think we've had a lot of discussion in committee about the need to have good data and to analyse exactly what's happened in terms of 1140 expansion. I'm particularly interested in 1 and 2 year olds. So obviously looking particularly at care experience, 1 and 2 year olds and 1 and 2 year olds in households where people are not in work. So I wonder if the minister can say something about to what depth will this research go into that 1 and 2 year old offer to better inform, you know, how we move forward?
I might refer to my official for that kind of in-depth answer.
So work has already commenced on understanding the impact of the early learning childcare offer on families and on children. In terms of the depth in which we'll go into, we have published details, and we can provide that to the committee separately about the elements that we'll look at and how we'll try and understand how that is impacting on families across Scotland. So we can provide that to the committee. I don't have details I can provide with you here today, but it's what we're looking at is how does it impact on the key determinants of child poverty? What does it do for families? We did publish quite significant detail on how we would look to take forward childcare in Scotland last year. So the strategic childcare plan that was published in October 2022 set out not just what we were hoping to do over the course of the term, but also the way that the outcomes were intended to be achieved and how we would hope to work with partners in the sector to deliver that. So that does set out quite clearly an intention to work with families and with the existing childcare sector providers to best understand what type of provision would make the greatest impact on all the age groups that it currently covers. The commitments that were announced in the programme for government just last week set out a plan where we'll introduce a number of early adopting communities, and that work will look in depth at what options are best for those age groups. We know that the type of childcare that's suitable for 3 and 4 year olds is very different to the type of childcare that is required for younger age groups, and those early adopting communities will look into that in great detail to understand how they should be delivered, and so that a targeted approach can be taken, both in terms of the different ages, but also in the evidence need in local areas across Scotland.
Thanks very much. I'm conscious of the time, so if I could just remind members to, when they're asking questions, to be as clear and concise and succinct as possible. It's to allow all members to come in if they have got any supplementaries as well. So I'm going to invite Bob Dorison. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks, Convener. Hugely ambitious plans to expand childcare in Scotland, free childcare. And really to be welcomed, but there's obviously a key challenge in how we sufficiently expand the childcare workforce to meet that increased supply of high-quality childcare. What are the challenges, but more importantly, what's the Scottish Government strategy for dealing with those challenges?
So I'm very switched on to the challenges. Again, I know the committee have heard evidence on that, and it's also been raised with me in various meetings that I've held with key stakeholders and organisations. In the programme for government, the member will be aware, the Scottish Government is committing to increasing pay to £12 an hour for early learning and childcare professionals working in the PVI sector who are delivering early learning funded provision. And I think this is a really, really important step. We will also expand the existing recruitment and retention pilots for childminders to grow this part of the workforce by 1,000 more by 26 to 27. And I think that these two actions coupled together are really critical steps towards addressing some of the issues around recruitment and retention that we are seeing. But I am also involved in further work. We'll also work closely with our partners, in particular the Care Inspectorate and the Scottish Social Services Council, to consider a robust regulatory and qualifications framework for what school-age childcare should look like. And obviously the pilot areas have already been mentioned in terms of determining that going forward. I think the work in these pilot areas recognises that the school-age childcare sector needs a varied workforce to meet the differing needs of children and families. We also have work going on with COSLA on the findings of the Joint Scottish Government and COSLA Review of Sustainable Rates. Again, something that has been raised with me in various different meetings, and I'm sure the member has switched on to, and this will be published later in the year, and we will determine what actions were taken as a result of that. So, important first steps just now, but there is still further work underway as well.
Minister, I won't ask any follow-up questions because of time, but just to note, the sustainable rates is vitally important. I sat up until the summer on the Education Committee, and that's something they're very alive to.
Yes.
But I just put that on the record.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm now going to invite Rose McCollin. Thanks.
Thank you, and thank you for coming to talk to us today. I'm going to come in on this, because we've had Barnett consequentials for rural that didn't make it to rural. We've had Barnett consequentials for swimming pools that didn't quite make it to swimming pools. So you can understand my concern. So I'm really important to know that Barnett consequentials coming from the UK government for childcare expansion. Can I have some guarantee that funding will definitely go to childcare expansion, knowing how important it is for us to move this forward?
Thank you for the question, and I don't have to tell the member the difficult public spending environment that we find ourselves in, and I completely appreciate the member's concerns. We are currently investing more than £1 billion in delivering childcare in 23 and 24, and as we have discussed this morning, we are announcing plans for further expansion, so it would absolutely, it is vital that we see funding continue to that. But in terms of investment in childcare, the member will be aware that budgets are set out through the budget process, and I wouldn't be able to foresee your comment on that at this moment in time.
Thank you. I appreciate again where the member is coming from. All the consequentials that are given to the Scottish Government are used. So if the member wishes to see more money going into childcare, the simple fact is it will have to come from somewhere else, and that will have to be taken into account as well. The consequentials are not sitting there unused. We have already invested in childcare, as Ms Dawn has said, but the money has to come from somewhere if the member is going to suggest more should be going into childcare.
May I just come back, because I really appreciate the Cabinet Secretary coming back with that, and I do understand that. But we have specific Barnett consequentials for childcare coming through because of the expansion programme in Westminster, and I'm just wondering if that was all going to be allocated, and it was really to make sure that it was all being being put across. So I appreciate where the Cabinet Secretary is coming back, and I appreciate the points made, and I accept that there has been money that has been made available for childcare, but that should be a simple process.
It's a simple process during the budget process, and if the member wishes, when she sees the budget, when it's produced, for money to be moved elsewhere, if she's not satisfied with what's in childcare, then it needs to come from somewhere else. So I simply state the fact that if the member wishes to use consequentials in a different way, I would suggest her party has to produce a balanced budget that would suggest where that would come from.
Okay, thank you. I'm now going to invite Bob Doddison. Thank you.
Just a brief supplementary, convener. This would be really helpful, Cabinet Secretary, when we do our budget scrutiny. There will, of course, be Barnett consequentials, but the 3- or 4-year-old offer in England is 570 hours childcare. In Scotland, it's 1,140. So I suspect there's a significant additional investment already being made in Scotland compared to England. It'd be quite helpful if we could get some pound signs around that, some figures around that, so when we do our budget scrutiny, we can see what the inputs are in Scotland for childcare provision compared to the rest of the UK, so we can make an informed decision during our budget process.
And certainly my understanding is, Ms Don will correct me if I'm wrong, or committee members will, the focus in the rest of the, or in England is on working parents. So again, if we are being asked to replicate what's happening down south, then that would actually suggest us taking away the actual offer that we have already for people who are not in work, which would be of a great concern to the government.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. So that concludes our discussion on the themes of childcare, and I'd like to thank the Minister and her official for coming along today. So I'm now briefly going to suspend the meeting to allow for a panel change before we move on to the next theme. Thank you. Welcome back. We will now continue our evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice and consider the themes of employability and fair, family-friendly working. I welcome Neil Gray, Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing Economy, Fair Work and Energy, and Eden Gracewood, Interim Director, Economic Strategy, Scottish Government. So thank you for attending today, and I understand you will also answer some questions under the policy coherence theme later as well. So I'm going to invite members to ask questions in turn, and I'm going to invite Katie Clark to come in. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And I presume that Neil Gray may be the appropriate Cabinet Secretary to direct this question to. And I want to ask about employability. And as you know, employability programmes have other priority groups as well as parents. So how do you ensure that parents become a high priority for all delivery partners of No One Left Behind?
I thank Katie Clark for that question, and good morning, colleagues. It's good to be back at my former committee. I recognise some faces around the table this morning. Yes, absolutely right. The employability programmes have parental employability as a key target. Obviously, we work with our partners to ensure that remains the case in terms of the work that they are doing. And I'll take Aidan in to provide a bit more detail on this in a second. And it, so far, it's been doing relatively well. We know that a quarter of all those that have been involved in the programmes go on to work, and a further quarter go on to a further positive destination, including further education or training. So we're pleased with that. There's obviously more work to do to make sure that that data can be contextualised, but it's obviously a key priority for us in terms of addressing the child poverty issues that the committee has been focused on, that we continue to make sure we're offering all the support that we possibly can within the resources that we have and local government has in order to support parents who often have been, in these cases, in the programmes that we have been furthest from the employment market. Mm-hmm. Well, I'll take Aidan. I don't know if you want to supplement any of that.
Yeah, happy to. And I'd just say, I suppose, just in terms of existing funding under No One Left Behind, there's joint working with COSLIN, the Joint Partnership Working Agreement, is to can focus efforts on that child poverty as a kind of shared mission, a shared target. So that feeds through into sort of prioritisation on the ground. And then more explicitly, there's the parental employment support money, which has been ramped up significantly this year. So that's really targeted explicitly on parents, both in work and out of work, in terms of raising incomes for that group.
Yes, and two-thirds of parents, two-thirds of children in poverty are in families where someone works. Will employability programmes support more working families, or do you expect that other policies will be more relevant for tackling poverty in working families? And maybe the Cabinet Secretary would like to answer that.
Yes, we are working with parents to try to ensure that they are getting access to further skills or training to be able to get them further on in the labour market. But Katie Clark is right to point to the other policies that we have around bringing up people's incomes. Obviously, we have the highest proportion of workers in Scotland compared to anywhere else in the UK that are paid at least the real mm-hmm. living wage, currently sitting at 91%. We don't rest on those laurels. Obviously, we're working with the Living Wage Campaign, Poverty Alliance and others to try to make sure that that continues to be ramped up, but also working with our public sector partners to ensure that we are introducing, as we did on the 1st of July, conditionality to our public sector funding, procurement funding, to ensure that we have the payment of the real living wage and also access to greater worker voice being part of that conditionality. So alongside the employability programmes that we have, we're also taking action in other ways to ensure that where we can, obviously we don't have full responsibility here, we don't have employment law powers, that we are taking the actions that we can within the devolved settlement to ensure that we're driving up people's pay.
Yes, I think we'll be coming on to procurement and conditionality later on.
Okay, thanks very much. Can I invite Bob Doris in?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I'm not sure which Cabinet Secretary this would best be directed to, because I think it probably crosses over, but you know, I'm aware the UK Government now provides childcare costs as part of Universal Credit. Well, I would note that's a capped provision under Universal Credit. I'm interested to know the relationship between that and the Parental Transition Fund, which was envisaged to be £15 million. And then asking that question, I know a reply, I think it was the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice replied to an IPQ just yesterday in relation to that, citing that perhaps limits to devolved powers interacting with the UK tax and benefit system means that that will still be delivered in some way, but not as originally envisaged. So I think the committee would quite welcome more details of what that means in practice, and I suppose what happens to that £15 million.
Thank you, Ed. I'll perhaps start, and then Neil Gray can follow in with some more detail. So, yes, we have been looking very carefully at the Parental Transition Fund, and we're very keen to move forward with this. But as has been stated, there was a question that was answered very recently, which showed that despite our work with stakeholders and with others to see what can be done around this area, given the devolved settlement, given the implications and the interactions with the tax and benefit system, it became very clear that it wasn't going to be possible to deliver the Parental Transition Fund as we'd originally envisaged. That's clearly very disappointing, but I am satisfied that we have worked with stakeholders to test that to the limits, and therefore we need to find other ways to be able to do that within the powers that we have. And very conscious with all of these things, we never want to do anything that jeopardises somebody's current benefit entitlement because of money that we may be putting through in a fund like that. So given those challenges, we will look to see what more can be done in this in other ways. Clearly, therefore, we have also, I would add, we welcome the changes that have been made on universal credit that were announced by the Chancellor. Those were welcome changes. There are still real challenges around that, around the awareness of that and how it's working practically. So it's something that we're keeping a very close eye on. Clearly, it's something that we as a government and stakeholders have been asking for some time. But now that we're into that implementation stage, we need to see whether it's genuinely making the difference that we had hoped it would. But I'm sure Neil will want to say a little bit more about some of this as well.
Yeah, but my only part to add is that the question that Mr Doris raised around where that funding has gone and it's been redeployed in order to ensure that the First Minister's commitment not just to double but to treble the fuel and security fund could be realised in this year. So that's where some of this year's budget allocation went to. But nothing further to add to what Shirley-Ann Somerville has already outlined.
That's very helpful. Can I just come back to Shirley-Ann Somerville? Very briefly, Convener, I think part of what you were saying in answer to myself, Cabinet Secretary, was that there maybe had been discussions with UK officials, whether at DWP or elsewhere, about how if that £15 million was to be deployed, there would be any unintended consequences and parents wouldn't lose out. You've been very diplomatic in relation to how fruitful or otherwise those discussions have been. And I get that there's a respectful relationship there at an official level between the two governments. But can you say any more about what those barriers were and what you've tried to do to resolve them?
I mean, we do work very closely, despite our many differences with the UK government on policy issues. The area around devolved social security is a joint programme, so we do need to work very carefully. This is just a simple matter of fact about where the powers lie within devolution and what we can do without having consequences on reserved issues. So it's a kind of statement of fact. I think we have all worked very hard to see where the boundaries could be pushed, but no one wants to get into a position where we're endangering someone's benefits. So it has run its course, I'm afraid, as a concept. But clearly the principle behind it was around supporting parents. So, for example, we already have tried to do what we can in these areas. Jobstart payment, the member will be well aware, again from time on Social Security Committee, around the work that we undertook on that. So we do what we can within the powers that we have, but there are limits to that, and then it's about making sure that what we have can be used most effectively. And that's where it goes into to Neil Gray's area around employability and further support that we can do.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I'd like to bring in Jeremy, but if I can just remind you to be as brief as possible. Thank you.
Always brief, Convener. I just wonder, with the Cabinet Secretary, obviously we have a power to create new benefits under the power. What have that looked at as a way of being introduced what you wanted to do, but just simply doing it via a new benefit?
So it's an interesting point, and again, Mr Balfour's vast experience on the Social Security Committee, he will know that the Jobstart payment was something that we had to do within a different way of using our powers for exactly some of the limitations I talked about. Clearly, the concern is how long that takes, because it requires legislation within Westminster. So even if we were to find an agreement and a way forward on that, it would take a considerable amount of time for that legislation to be able to go through. We saw that through Jobstart payment and some of the challenges that were involved around the establishment of Jobstart payment. So when you're faced with those types of barriers, I think it is imperative that the government looks at what could be done quicker, and that's why we've moved to see what more can be done to support parents into employment through the employability work that Neil Gray's already discussed. So it's not that it's ruled out for the future, but given the urgency of this issue, I certainly wouldn't be content to wait, and therefore we haven't done work to see what would be done on that. It's more about what we can do now rather than some theoretical point in the future, but it's something that could of course be looked at.
Just very quickly, sorry, just a bit confused by your answer there. Why would it need Westminster legislation? Why couldn't we just pass legislation here in the Scottish Parliament to introduce a new benefit which would then supplement that income that you were wanting to pass on to people? I'm not quite sure why it would need Westminster.
So
approval.
I'm giving an example of the Jobstart payment. I mean, the setup that did require that did require Westminster legislation to go through to give us the powers to do that. We could set up another benefit theoretically. It still has implications for reserves benefits, even if we decide to do something ourselves. Those implications will still remain, and that's why, even if we have the powers, even if we went forward for that, the challenges about how it interacts with the UK benefits would still exist.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm now going to invite James Dornan in, and he's joining us remotely. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretaries. Can you tell me, how is the Scottish Government enabling flexible working throughout the public sector, particularly for those whose jobs cannot be done from home?
I think that'll be for me. I thank Mr. Dornan for that question. Obviously, we've got a challenge here in that, as I'd said previously, employment law is a reserved area of responsibility, and we welcome the fact that the UK government came forward with the Fair Work Bill, which helps to ensure that there is a greater consistency of work that the Scottish Government had been pushing forward for some time before that, and some of the conditionality that we had in our contracts, where we were looking for people to be able to offer fair work from day one of employment, so and flexible working from day one. That is now a requestable right under the Flexible Working Bill. But obviously we want that to go further, and we continue to work to impress upon the UK Government of the need to do that, not least because of the changing working practices that have been accelerated post-COVID, where Mr Dornan is able to join us remotely, which is really good because it means that we're able to hear from him, where otherwise, in other circumstances, we may not have. And it's the same for other people that are that have challenging personal situations that mean that they may not be able to work in person, but are able to contribute remotely, for instance, may have childcare or other caring responsibilities that they need to either or would like to either compress hours or work on a more flexible basis. So we very much understand understand the need for greater flexibility in working. We've been working with employers through the summer since I've come into post and previously with previous ministers on how we can do more to encourage that. But ultimately, the responsibility to legislate on that is for the UK government and not for us. But we're certainly very much committed to ensuring that we have as flexible a working environment as possible across Scotland.
Okay, can I ask just further to that, how you would see the use of procurement to help encourage that flexible and family-friendly working?
So obviously, I thank Mr Donnan. Obviously, we have already come forward with conditionality on public procurement, and I've spoken in response to Katie Clark around some of that in practical terms around paying the real living wage, as well as offering greater worker voice. And we keep under review our conditionality regime to ensure that we are being as proportionate as possible, but also driving the strongest possible outcomes. And we've also provided significant funding to the likes of Flexibility Works and others to help ensure that businesses are aware of the benefits of providing flexible workplaces, but also the practical things that they can do in order to support their employees in that process. I'm happy to bring Aidan in if there's anything further that I would need to add to that, anything that I've missed.
I suppose I'd also just say, on top of the money and the funding that's been put forward to help private sector employers, encouraging them to, you know, use flexible working practices and set out the benefits. I'd also just flag, as a public sector, quite a lot of work being done by major public sector organisations too in this space. Sometimes out of necessity, in terms of making sure that you can get the workforce that you need, but also the principles of Fair Work First being applied. So NHS being a particular example, where a lot of work's been taken forward. So they've got a supporting work-life balance, workforce policies, and, you know, a lot of work across the NHS system now in terms of guidelines on helping encourage more flexible working practices and some practical things there as well. So, so it's leading by example there.
The last thing I would say to Mr Dornan is that the programme for government also committed us to piloting a four-day working week in the public sector. It's not necessarily a policy commitment in terms of whether that would be the right or the wrong area to pursue, but it is important that we pilot, get the information as to how supportive or otherwise that is for people, how that works practically, and we'll come forward with more detail in due course on how that will operate.
Yes, thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much. We'll now focus on social security rules as well as governance, policy coherence and evaluating policy impact. Can I invite Marie McNair? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretaries and your officials. I know from my constituents that the Scottish Child Payment is a big help with such a difficult time for many during this cost of living crisis. And it's a massive investment in children, but understandably there's obviously calls for us to increase it. Can you advise us, the Scottish Government's position on increasing the payment, Cabinet Secretary?
Thank you. So clearly the Scottish Child Payment has made a difference. We're hearing that directly from stakeholders and also some of the evidence I quoted in my introductory remarks around the importance of it. It is very clear that there are calls for it to be further increased, and I do appreciate where those calls for coming from. I do think it's important to have a bit of context, however. I remember when the Scottish Child Payment was initially launched, the campaigners were asking for £5 per week per eligible child, and we are now at £25 per week per eligible child. And I hope that that does show to committee the very serious considerations that are given across government to see what can be done to increase it. The challenge, and the committee's heard it before in other answers previously this morning, the challenge is around the financial situation that we find ourselves in and the context. So, as the First Minister has made clear, we will look to see what we can do on the Scottish Child Payment. and indeed on any other anti-poverty measures to see what more can be done on that. But it will always have to be done, of course, within the financial context that we're in. So we'll consider it very seriously in the run-up to the next budget, along with the other asks, and there are many that people would wish us to take forward on these issues, but it will have to be done within the financial reality of which we're in.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I get that budgets are tight and under pressure. Can you assure committee, though, that the Scottish Government will never introduce a cap or a two-child limit on the Scottish Child Payment?
Absolutely not. I mean, that's one of the areas that has never even been considered when we looked to introduce the Scottish Child Payment, but whether this should be done, because it is inherently an unjust way of delivering a benefit. Members will know from their own constituency mailbags that our constituents' life circumstances can change in the blink of an eye, and to be able to suggest that we should use the benefit system to in some way punish people who have third, fourth, more children than that is deeply disappointing, particularly when we see that the number of families with more children that are in poverty. That's exactly why they're one of our priority areas to look at. So we would never even consider that, given the impact it has on families right across Scotland.
Thanks for that assurance, Cabinet Secretary. The way Universal Credit treats income means claimants can quickly lose entitlement, and obviously UC is a passport benefit for the Scottish Child Payment. Do you believe a taper or a run-on should be considered for the Scottish Child Payment to stop entitlement being lost?
So this very much does come down to the legislative background of how the Scottish Child Payment was set up. I would remind members that this was established in 18 months. It was the quickest delivery of a benefit that's ever happened anywhere in the UK. And again, that showed the importance that the government placed on that at this time. To do that, it was necessary to deliver it as a top-up to current reserved benefits. So you need to be, for example, in receipt of Universal Credit to be able to receive the Scottish Child Payment. It's therefore not possible, given the legislative underpinning of the Scottish Child Payment, to allow payment of the Scottish Child Payment to someone that's not in receipt of, for example, Universal Credit. So it's not something that's possible given the way that the Scottish Child Payment was set up. But I hope I've explained to members about why we set it up in the way that we did.
Thanks for that. There's plans to make the conditionality regime worse with disabled people now on the radar, and yet the two main Westminster parties remain wedded to sanctions. In mitigation, the Scottish Government changed obviously the Scottish Welfare Fund guidelines to allow crisis grants to those who are sanctioned. Do you think the Scottish Government and councils are doing enough to promote this assistance that's available? I know that certainly in my own mailbox, I do refer to this the scheme.
So the number of individuals who are being sanctioned is of great concern. And particularly when you look at the numbers pre-pandemic, during pandemic, post-pandemic, and I'm happy to provide information for the sake of time to committee on the level of sanctions that are currently impacting on people. Given the fact that we are greatly concerned as a government about the impact of sanctions on people, then it is imperative that there is something in place like the Scottish Welfare Fund to be able to assist people with that. That's exactly why the Scottish Government remains committed to that welfare fund. Now, it is delivered by local authorities. They are responsible for ensuring the promotion of that to people. It's something that we clearly work with them on, and we consider always with them what more can be done to ensure that people are aware of that, because I do recognise the member's point about the type of individuals that can be impacted by sanctions are, again, some of the areas that are in the priority groups that we've identified within Best Start, Bright Futures. Now, it's a concern when anyone's sanctioned, but to actually see the people getting hit the hardest are some of the most vulnerable in our society is of even greater concern.
Thanks, Convener. We will certainly welcome that further information to the committee. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you. I'm now going to bring in Paul O'Kane. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener. Just a brief supplementary on uptake of the Scottish Child Payment. Cabinet Secretary will recall I asked the First Minister about the concern that 60,000 families might miss out in terms of payments, and he gave that absolute guarantee that work has been undertaken to make sure we reach as many families as possible. So I just wonder if the Cabinet Secretary might update committee on progress of that work.
So it's a very important issue to ensure that we not only have the benefit in place, but people know about the benefit and are encouraged and assisted to be able to apply for that. Happy to provide, again, the committee with the most recent levels of uptake, which I think, from memory, shows that the number in receipt of Scottish Child Payment is actually now greater than the Scottish Fiscal Commission's forecasts of what they thought. So I hope that demonstrates to the member the further work that the government has done on this. But as you've heard from Mr Gray, we don't rest on our laurels. We know there are more people out there in this example that require Scottish Child Payment. That's why we take very seriously the work that local delivery does within Social Security Scotland to be able to assist people with benefit applications. That's why we've obviously got the continuing commitment to provide support for welfare and advice to ensure again that people are supported, and critically that this is made as simple as possible as well. But we are always looking for more ways to be able to increase benefit uptake, and very happy to work with the committee if there are suggestions about what more we can do on that, because I share Mr O'Kane's concerns about this and his enthusiasm to make sure the government is pressed as much as possible on it.
Thank you.
Okay. Can I invite Bob Dorison?
Thanks, Convener. The Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice will be aware, because I've made these calls in the Chamber previously, that if we are looking at increasing the Scottish Child Payment, and I'm afraid, Cabinet Secretary, I can't identify where that cash would come from. Well, these are the battles you're grappling with in a budgetary environment. But that a summer supplement of the Scottish Child Payment in June towards the summer holidays would be a real focused benefit for a lot of families that really struggle for those 6.5 weeks with the kids at, you know, at home and not at school. So that's something I've asked to be considered previously. Also, I've got a 7-year-old and a 2-year-old. Kids grow pretty quickly. I'm fortunate that I can, clothe my children, but the school clothing grant is really important for many as well. I know it's been uplifted in recent years, but the idea of a supplement to the clothing grant at a later time in the academic year as well. So two calls for funding, Cabinet Secretary, I get that. I suppose the point I'm trying to get to, Convener, is that we have to make sure the limited funds that we do have, and when we do spend it, we spend it in a focused and effective way. And those were two suggestions that I've made. Are they still under consideration?
I will add Mr Dorsey's request to the long list of suggestions about how I can spend money that currently is already fully committed within the social justice portfolio and across government. But I do take very seriously the points that he raises around this. We are very keen as a government to ensure that we are supporting families at some of the most difficult financial times, but that's exactly why we have the Best Start Foods, for example, which of course the committee will be aware we are suggesting changes to income levels for. That's why we've got the Best Start Pregnancy and Baby Payment, the Nursery and the School Age Child Payment, to recognise that. And of course why, as he mentioned, that school clothing grant is being uplifted by inflation. But I do recognise there are always calls for us to do more on that, and we will work very carefully with the committee and with others about the prioritisation, because with a number of calls it requires us all to think about how we prioritise the many ways that we could further assist families, which I do absolutely appreciate is a really difficult time for many people.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. We appreciate, as a committee, that you've taken forward those requests, so thank you for that. I'm now going to invite Ros McCall.
Thank you. And thank you again. And it's very important to me that active change is made. And I really want to sort of highlight this, because we've got this employment offer, and it's to support a 1,200 parents to achieve a 2 percentage point reduction in child poverty by 2026, I believe. So how is the impact of the employment offer being evaluated, given that it includes other services such as childcare and transport, as well as employability? And what assurances can you give that the target time frame will actually be met, given that it's such an important subject matter?
Thank you very much. I thank Ros McCall for that question. It's an important commitment, but not least because of what Charlie-Anne Somerville was touching on there around the heavy lifting that's been done on the social security side already to reduce child poverty, and through the various measures that we have taken across government. We're pleased with the fact that 90,000 children in Scotland have been taken out of poverty, in large part through the Scottish Child Payment, but through other measures as well, including our work around employability and ensuring that we're driving up fair work practices. We have a constant evaluation of our employability programmes, making sure that they are tailored in an effective a way as possible, and making sure that the transition that there is from the previous to the new is about making sure that we can respond to the local need that is being delivered there. The target around 12,000, the Spice briefing sets out the number that have already been taken through and supported. We're looking at, I think it's approaching 11,000 that have been supported across the two programmes, and as I've already said, a quarter are moving into employment and a further quarter moving into positive destinations, including further education or training. But it's an important consideration for us around how we can make sure that we are tailoring it both for those with long-term health conditions and disabilities, but also parents, to ensure as target groups that for us reaching our child poverty targets, that that is as effective as possible. We're making sure that the data that we collect from that is as effective and wide-ranging as possible to ensure that we can carry out that effective monitoring of those programmes. But it demonstrates the fact that addressing child poverty isn't just for the social security system alone. We have to be looking at wider interventions, which is why we have come forward with the programmes that we have, but also how incumbent it is upon the other drivers of poverty that are coming away from Scotland, the decisions that have been taken on our behalf at UK government level to be scrutinised as well, because we've already heard the impact that has been had on families across Scotland. The decision to have a social security cap and two-child limit is having an incredible impact on families, and what we are trying to do is mitigate the difficulties that that is posing. It would be much better if we had a responsibility taken at source of those decisions and changes made so that we're able to see those targets met.
Can I just come back on a couple of points, if I may? It's purely just because, as much as I accept entirely, the remit is about child poverty and parental employment, which is exactly what we're trying to do. So, of course, I accept wholeheartedly the child poverty aspect, but the parental employment, as much as we need to monitor that, we need to make sure that there is actually a long-term process. Now, you talked about positive destinations, but we look at positive destinations in education, and that can be over a 3 to 6 month period. So it's really about long-term sustainability, and are we tracking that properly, and are we sure that getting parents back into employment will mean that that actually is a positive move for a long-term process, and do we have the ability to be able to monitor that properly and come back so that we know that we're actually doing what we're meant to be doing on the ground?
Yeah. Yeah, I appreciate that, and I'll bring Aidan Griswood in to supplement the information that I'm able to impart. But I go back to the importance of the interaction with the UK government, because many of those that interact with the Scottish Government's employability schemes are signposted through the Job Centre network. So ensuring that we have a good interaction, a good relationship there is very important, and also making sure that there is a supportive environment and a supportive system at UK level to ensure people feel able to come and interact with the Job Centre network is critically important. In terms of our tracking and monitoring, yes, we look at 3, 6, 12 month junctures to ensure that we're understanding where people are in their journey. And that's where the information that the statistics have already given comes from. But we're always looking at what more we can do, working with our partners in local government who deliver many of these programmes, as well as community and voluntary sector colleagues, to ensure that we're taking as much information as possible, that, as Ros McCall suggests, that we are monitoring and evaluating that those investments to ensure they're as effective as possible. But I don't know if Aidan wants to add to anything that I've missed.
Just to supplement what the Cabinet Secretary said, you know, explicitly on the evaluation frameworks, there's been a lot of time and effort put into that. So developing a shared measurement framework that's used by all partners so they can do that tracking. Some statistics that the Cabinet Secretary mentioned were experimental statistics. So this is stuff that we're developing as we go along and improving as we go along. The 12,000 figure was based on modelling work, but obviously that was based on the assumptions at the time. But again, we want to improve that as we go along, informed by the results that are coming from the various evaluation frameworks we've put in place. And I think I'd also say it's a stretch target, and purposely so, because as time goes on, we want to make sure that that framework informs good practice, both in terms of that quantitative evidence that's set out, and that's always really challenging, and picking the various elements of that, because the economic context is changing as well as the policy context all the time too. But also there's the qualitative evidence, and just bringing the various local employment partnerships, they work closely together. We've got improvement service involved as well through COSLA, which are actually really thinking about how do we get that best practice shared between different partners so that it can be replicated in different areas and informed. So I think purposely so, that it's stretch in that respect.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'm now going to invite Paul Keane. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'm interested, to try and pull together a lot of our discussion this morning to look at the kind of cross-cutting nature of anti-poverty work across government. And really, how, in the view of Cabinet Secretaries, are we embedding essentially those actions on child poverty across government? So I appreciate it's quite a broad question, but I think it would be useful for committee to just have a bit of an overview, and then perhaps we can delve into any other detail.
Sure. This is an important area, and I think the fact that this is clearly a cross-cutting area of government is demonstrated by how many ministers we've had along today, and indeed you could have had more. I'm not suggesting you do on behalf of my other ministers, but we could have had more. And it is a very serious point about how we ensure that we're coordinating the work and facilitating the implementation. And importantly, to ensure that we are prioritising work around child poverty within government. So, for example, I will give a couple of examples, and if Mr O'Kane wishes further detail, I can go into it. We have the programme board, which is at official level right across government, that looks at the specifically Best Start, Bright Futures and the key action points within that. That reports regularly on implementation around challenges and indeed opportunities where they arise, to see what more can be done and when. I'm also will chair a ministerial group right across government to ensure that, again, ministers have oversight. Now, our intention at the moment is for that to meet quarterly. And that goes on top of what the programme board is already looking at, to again make sure that we're coming together. Now, you'll of course expect that we have regular discussions when we meet bilaterally, when we meet in Cabinet around key areas, but this ability for us to take a step back and have real-time right across ministerial portfolios to look at that is something which we're very keen to do. And of course, we have a number of evaluation strategies which look at what is happening, the impact of it, and then again, further analysis about does that require change in portfolios, and that's some of the aspects around the programme board. So I hope that gives Mr O'Kane a kind of flavour of what's going on, but of course, if he wishes further details, myself and perhaps Julie can furnish him with that.
I wonder if I can just briefly thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but I'm also interested in I mean, that's useful in terms of the government, but obviously the nature of this work will involve other agencies. It involves local government as a strong partner. I mean, local government are facing huge challenges, not least in terms of resource. You know, can the Cabinet Secretary just say something about the government's work on this agenda with local government?
Of course, and he raises again a very important point, but that's exactly why this is one of the areas that we were very keen and that local government were very keen to have at the heart of the Verity House agreement, where we have that shared objective around tackling child poverty. So there is a great deal of work that goes on within that scope, both government to COSLA and government separately with local authorities. Clearly, the committee will be aware of the requirements around local child poverty action reports, which are the local government responsibility for this. But this is just about local authorities. There are about many other aspects to this as well. But I don't know, Julie, if you want to provide any further detail?
Of course. One of the important things to note is that COSLA and SOLIS are both represented on the Tackling Child Poverty Programme Board, and we work very closely with them to ensure that we understand where the risks and opportunities are for delivery partners, so we can help work together to prioritise the huge amount of work that needs to go on across the public sector. One of the other things it's worth noting, in addition to the local child poverty action reports that need to be done by local authorities and NHS boards jointly, is that we have obviously the Fairer Scotland duty, which is a key consideration across kind of the public sector in terms of how to inform policies and how they will reduce inequalities and poverty in terms of how they are delivered. And obviously local authorities and indeed territorial health boards are covered by that as well. So we're trying to ensure that at every layer we're thinking about the impact of policies in terms of inequalities and how we reduce them further.
Can I just supplement that as well, Convener? Obviously, the First Minister has set this as being one of his areas of priority for government within his prospectus. He held a child poverty roundtable that had representatives from all parties earlier in the summer, and has tasked us as Cabinet Secretaries and Ministers to go away and do our own Tackling Child Poverty roundtables with our stakeholder network. So I had a session there with employers and others within my portfolio responsibility, looking at areas that we could work together on, either that government could do more or indeed our stakeholders could be doing more with our support, with a view to taking that back across different portfolios to a follow-up session that the First Minister will be leading, so that to ensure that we have that coherence across government, but also having it as a driving priority for all of us, whether it's a direct responsibility as it is for Charlotte-Anne, or whether we have additional responsibilities within our own portfolios that are linked to ensuring that we're tackling child poverty.
Okay. Thanks very much. So that actually concludes all our questions. So I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretaries and their officials today, and the committee will consider all of the evidence heard and report in the near future as well. So I'll now briefly suspend the meeting before we move to the next agenda item with the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice. So thank you again for attending today. So welcome back for our final item in public today. We will now discuss other priorities relevant to this committee. So thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for staying with us. And I'm now going to invite members to ask questions, and I'm going to invite Katie Clark. Thank you.
Thank you. And Cabinet Secretary, in equality, opportunity, community, new leadership, a fresh start, the First Minister stated that there would be some tough decisions to ensure that we target every pound we spend and invest in order to get the maximum value, ensuring it reaches those most in need. How have these tough decisions affected the measures set out in the programme for government? And have you had to change or refocus priorities?
So the First Minister has made it very clear, as his Cabinet Secretaries do on regular occasions, that this is a challenging financial time and context that we are in. And we need to take that very seriously as a government. Our medium-term financial strategy again set out some of those challenges as a result, for example, of sustained high inflation caused by the economic shocks that Scotland has faced. That inevitably has had an impact. So yes, there will have to be tough decisions on that. An example again of the context of which we are in is, I think, something I mentioned in my introductory remarks about the block grant funding being 4.8% lower in real terms in 21-22 than at the time this budget was set. So clearly there is an impact on national government as we then look to it because of the mini-budget, because of Brexit, because of austerity that present us with that challenge. What we are trying very hard to do, and what the First Minister has laid out to stakeholders now that we have that context ahead of us, is about how we can best use our resources. And I've touched on some of the work that goes on within government to ensure that we are analysing how we're using the finances that we do have in the right way through the Best Start Bright Futures Programme Board, the Ministerial Group and so on, to constantly check in that what we are doing is using the money in the most effective way possible. So that will be something which will be on all Cabinet Secretaries' mind as we move forward in the budget process to see what stakeholders are asking us to do and also what we can do within the budget, and that will require us to take tough decisions right across government. So clearly I can't go into those today as we're at the very foothills of the budget process for next year, but that context will be live with us throughout that process.
So how do you go about assessing the potential impact of policies in order to ensure that resources are focused on those policies likely to have the biggest impact? How are you going to go about that?
So some of the work, again, I give examples of this, and if committee requires further details, we can go into that. Some of the examples around that are, of course, around some of the impact assessments which are undertaken when policies are being developed, and we work very closely with stakeholders as we do so. It's also very important that we have the analysis and the modelling which is done that supports Best Start Bright Futures to challenge ourselves to see the impact that is happening through our policies, and therefore to challenge ourselves about what more we can do, whether the money is being used to the best opportunity available. I would be clear also that that modelling has to take account of what is impacting from elsewhere, out with the Scottish Government's powers that also impact on child poverty levels, for example. But that modelling is very important. A kind of evidence-based approach to this is critical. And if I can just touch on social security as an example, convener, also of what we do. Clearly, when we're looking at social security policies, there's a great deal of work that goes in the development of those policies with those with lived experience as well as stakeholders to ensure that we are delivering the best possible benefit in the best possible way that can reach the maximum number of people. And we touched on the issue of take-up earlier on, which is clearly something which we are very committed to, which is why we have a benefit take-up strategy, unlike the UK government, which does not.
And will you give consideration as to how much of that work can be shared with this committee so that we can, you know, assess whether we think you've come to the right conclusions?
Well, I think this is one of the areas which we are keen to try and work on. And I think that benefits government as well, because I have no doubt we've done a little bit of it today. I have no doubt we'll do more of it as we look at budget scrutiny. The many asks that come to government and the many challenges that government has about delivering on those asks, not just financial, but sometimes practically, about how long it takes for a policy to be implemented, if it requires primary legislation or secondary legislation, etc., or indeed if it requires changes to the social security system that we have within the agency. So there are practical considerations as well. So very thoughtful to that point. There is a great deal that's already published. I would think, happy Julie, if you want to come in a little bit more on that, because the work that we do annually around this, I think, is really important.
So when we published Best Start Bright Futures, we had an underpinning evaluation strategy, which we also published. And one of the key components of that is the cumulative impact assessment of all of the policies that government put in place and what that means in terms of the impact. And alongside the annual report that we published on Best Start Bright Futures in June this year, we updated that cumulative impact assessment. And that draws on a huge amount of data from across government in terms of the policies that we are putting in place and what impact they are having in terms of the six priority family groups in particular.
Thank you. No, thank you, that's really helpful. I'm now going to invite Bob Doris. Thanks.
Thanks, Commissioner. Really reassuring, Cabinet Secretary, to see you're taking an evidence-based approach to monitoring all of this. I'm sure you'll do that as part of my calls that I can't actually fund myself, of course, Cabinet Secretary, for a summer supplement Scottish Child Payment. It's not to say that should happen, it's to make sure that that is put into that matrix along with everything else in case that is the best value for delivering the outcomes that we want to see. But how do we monitor need, I suppose, is the question. So what would your latest assessment be on the impact, for instance, of the cost of living crisis on families that are struggling? Because, of course, that's a snapshot in time, but how do we monitor that more generally on an ongoing basis, given the cost of living crisis that we're currently experiencing?
So I mentioned in my introductory remarks, Julie's touched on a little bit more of it about the modelling that's done around the 90,000 children that have been lifted out of poverty because of Scottish Government policies. And that is a very, very important aspect that we have. To put that within a context, again, of the impact of the impact on the Scottish Government budget of delivering such policies, clearly we've allocated almost £3 billion last year and this year to support policies which tackle poverty and protect people as far as possible from the cost of living crisis. And we recognise that that is something which is a very important aspect of the government's work. Now, that is a significant investment. It's the right thing to do. But, of course, clearly, everything that we do in this area means we're not doing something somewhere else. So I give us a particular example of that, if I can, convener, around the £127 million which we use to mitigate against specific UK government welfare policies. And I think actually it was Mr Doris himself who suggested that we should actually be viewing the Scottish Child Payment as a mitigation measure as well in one of our recent debates, which is over £400 million because quite frankly, if universal credit was at a sufficient level, then there may be no need for the Scottish Government to continuously be supporting children to the extent that we are. So the mitigation is clearly a very important factor that we do need to do, but it's not without its implications for other parts of the budget. But I'm happy to go into any more detail that committee may wish about that almost £3 billion, should that be of use to the committee either now or in writing.
Cabinet Secretary, thank you for that. I suspect my eagerness to lobby my own government in public session of committee lost the focus of what my question should have been, so apologies to the convener that I'll maybe ask that some more. I suppose the question at the heart was, how do we monitor on an ongoing basis the impact of the cost of living crisis on families that may be struggling? So what process would government would carry out around that? And of course, we would be keen to know as a committee what more you think is a priority to do.
So the monitoring that we've already discussed for Best Start Bright Futures will pick up the impacts of this, which is exactly why, despite the fact that the Scottish Government is investing that almost £3 billion, clearly that would be having more of an impact if we weren't in a position of the high inflation, of the UK government welfare policies and of other external factors which are impacting on people. So the work that is done within that modelling will pick up the fact that, yes, the Scottish Government is making an impact, but clearly we would be making more of an impact if there wasn't a more difficult financial context. So hopefully that explains to committee in the time I've got available, but again, happy to provide more information about how that modelling is done in writing, if that would assist, perhaps.
OK, thank you.
I think the committee would very much welcome that, so thank you. I'm now going to invite Jeremy in. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if I can just take you back to the first question that was asked by my colleague in regard to the information we have. I think we all want the information so that we can assess how it's going. And one of the disappointments was the letter that we received over the summer from David Wallace, the Chief Executive of Social Security Scotland, who told us they're not monitoring at all the time allocation from when someone puts an application in for new benefits to when that application is being processed. And I'm just wondering, is that an issue with the design system made by Scottish Government, or is that an issue with Social Security Scotland not using the system properly? And are you concerned about this? And if so, what are you doing about it?
If the committee will forgive me, I'm not exactly sure about the specific reference that Mr Wallace made in the letter. Clearly, there is analysis which goes on within the agency around how long it takes to process a case. It may not be from the specific timeframes that Mr Balfour is looking for, but I'd be happy to refer back to the evidence session to see the exact question that was asked, the letter that was provided around that, and provide the information. But I take very seriously, as I know the agency does, around processing times, about how long that takes. We know that there is more to do on that issue. I meet with the agency very regularly to discuss that and discuss the changes that have been made to improve that. So the aspects around processing time are actually published. The processing time is published within official statistics. So if you'll forgive me, Mr Balfour, I'll take a further look at the reference in particular that you've made and refer back to Mr Balfour if I need to provide further clarification on that point.
Thank you.
I just come in there and just confirm that we are aware on your request, Jeremy, about the letter in question, and it will come up in our work programme for the committee to discuss that letter in the next few weeks. So thank you. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that offer as well. And I'll just invite Jeremy back in. Thanks.
Thank you. Sorry, yes. I wonder if we can just move on to one of the other areas within your portfolio, your very wide portfolio, a matter of homelessness. We are seeing levels of homelessness going up and the use of temporary accommodation. I wonder how important is temporary accommodation in regard to a short-term answer for that, and is the government working to provide more temporary accommodation, particularly in hotspots such as Lothian and Glasgow?
Well, this is an area of great concern, the levels of homelessness, the levels of families in particular that are in temporary accommodation is a concern. That's why the government had established a temporary accommodation task and finish group, which set up some actions for government to take. We've responded to that, and I give some examples of that around the £60 million available this year To support national acquisition plan to ensure that we're working with social landlords to deliver a new programme of stock management, because we actually see this working very successfully in particular local authorities, but it's not something which is being used perhaps to the same extent right across the 32. Now every council will have their own stock management process and policies, but it's an example, I hope, of local and national government working together to share good practice about where that's clearly made an impact. Obviously, as well, we will continue with the affordable housing supply programme, and we are very much looking at working with particular local authorities that have hotspots that Mr Balfour has mentioned. Edinburgh is one of the key examples of that, where we're working with the local authority and asking them about the specific solutions which they would wish to see in place to support them. Now, clearly, again, we then have to work in the financial context that we're all in, but there is something that we're doing around national, and then working with particular local authorities where there is either good practice or where there's specific housing needs that need to be looked at. And the Housing Minister is meeting with housing conveners and many others in local authorities to take that particular work forward with each local authority that requires that.
I'm grateful for that, and thanks for coming to for that, and perhaps updates would be helpful as we go along. I just wonder, had there been any analysis done of a change in regard to the rental market with the emergency legislation that was brought in last year? Is there still the same amount of social temporary accommodation available, particularly in Edinburgh and Glasgow, or are we seeing landlords moving away from this by selling the property? Has there been any work done to analyse that?
I'm not aware of any concerns around level of temporary accommodation and the impact that Mr Balfour suggests that our work on rent caps will have. I'm happy to liaise with Mr Harvey and Mr McClellan on this issue to see whether there's any further updates that are required. But clearly it is very important that we do take action to support people within the private rented sector. The issue of high rents is something which doesn't just affect Scotland, but happens to affect those throughout the UK. So it is very important that we take that very seriously. But we also have to take very seriously any impact it has on the size of the private rented sector and on landlords. And that's why the Minister of Housing meets regularly with private landlords, representative bodies and others to ensure that he really very clearly hears any concerns and suggestions that they may have. As I think, I hope we all have a shared interest and responsibility in providing support to those in the private rented sector from exceptionally high rent level increases.
Thank you, Gillian.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm now going to invite Marie McNair. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary again. Industrial injuries disablement benefit has pretty much been left unreformed by the major Westminster parties, even though it came into effect in 1948. And it's usual it's left to this Parliament to lead in positive reforms. When are you likely to publish a consultation on the new employment injury assistance scheme?
So this is something that I am giving active consideration to, but the Member's quite right to point to the challenges. I mean, this is literally still a paper-based system sitting in a large warehouse where it is not set up to, even if we wanted to, lift and shift Scottish cases from the paper-based system and take them up to Scotland. So the fact that we're looking at a system that hasn't been touched and is really quite archaic in the way that it is currently administered, makes it a real challenge for it to come up here. And committee will be well aware and rightly question me on the costs of the devolution programme for Social Security. And there is inevitably more costs to being able to provide a benefit up here when we're not able in any way, shape or form to do it from a lift and shift from a digitally based programme down south. So that does present us with great challenges, and we need to be very cognisant of, therefore, of the cost of devolving and what that would mean. That's why I'm looking very carefully at how this can be done, and we will have to look at the cost, not just of the benefit of itself, but actually the implementation and how people will want to do that. So there's a number of ways that can be done. As I say, it's not without cost. So it is something, as I say, I'm giving consideration to, not able to provide the committee with a date when we would go live with that consultation at this point, though.
Thank you. The previous Minister for Social Security gave a commitment to groups with knowledge and experience, and had the meeting with the Minister and Clybank Asbestos Group in constituency to be involved in the design of the new benefit. Can you give a commitment that that will be acted on?
We'll be very happy to carry on that work once the consultation in particular goes live. I mean, I think there's a good track record of the government working with those most directly impacted by benefits to help shape the focus of the benefit. So that will obviously include people that currently receive it, or also those who may perceive barriers to them receiving that type of benefit as well. But I'm happy to reaffirm that commitment that my colleague made previously.
Thank you for that.
Okay, so that concludes all of our questions this morning to the Cabinet Secretary. And so I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for attending our meeting today and her officials as well. So that concludes our public business. And next week we will take evidence on the Carers Assistance Carer Support Payment Scotland Regulations 2023. And on the 24th and 25th, we will be looking at the budget as well. So we'll now move into private to consider the remaining items on the agenda. Thank you very much.